Self-locating strings are to do with decimal places of irrational numbers. So we need a number with an infinitely long decimal expansion that is irrational, of course. So we're basically going to do pi. You probably guessed we're going with pi. So these are the first few digits of the decimal expansion of pi. And what we want to do for these self-locating strings is to label each position after the decimal point. So we're going to start with the first number. So this is the first position, the second position, the third. And then the question you ask yourself to find the self-locating string is you want the number to match its position in the decimal expansion. So here we've got our first one straight away. The very first digit, number one, is in the first place. So that would be our first self-locating string. And then what we want to do is continue along through the numbers and see if we can find any others. Of course, the expansion is infinite, so we're going to hope that there should be some more.
So if the second number there had been a 2, that would have worked as well, but it's a 4, so...
Exactly. So if this was this would need to be a 2, this would need to be a 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So none of these work yet. And the other thing is, once we, of course, get to double digit or triple digit positions, if we were, for example, considering the 12th number of the decimal expansion, we would need the 12th position to be a 1 and then next to it the 2. So you actually would need a 1 in the 12th position and a 2 in the 13th position. If you think about that a little bit, you're probably, they're sort of most common near the beginning when you just have one number that needs to be in one fixed position. And then when you get to 2-digit, 3-digit, 4-digit, you have several requirements that need to happen in a row, so your probability gets smaller.
So for position 1 million, you would need position 1 million to be a 1, and then the next 6 positions after that to all be 0.
Exactly. So that's very, very unlikely, let's be honest, right? Compared to just having, let's say, you know, a 7 at position 7 or something. If the numbers are truly random, which is generally what we assume in the expansion of pi, that each one appears approximately equal probability. If that is indeed true, then you know, you're going to see or expect to see more of the lower down self-locating digits compared to the higher up ones further along. We've got our first one, which is a good start. So what we now need to do is I need to write out more digits of pi. So I'm going to have to look this up, I'll be honest. That's about as good as it gets for me in terms of knowing pi, what, 3.14? 7 decimal places, you know. You don't really need more than 7 decimal places. There we go. The first 100 digits of pi. That was painful. We've got our first self-locating string here at position 1. And what we can now do is continue to look through these numbers. And without even doing this, I can already tell you there aren't any more. The next ones are really, really far away. So after 1, right, at the very first digit, we get our self-locating string. It's super exciting. We think they're going to be really common. They're not. The next one is at 16,470. So I'm definitely not writing out 16,000 digits of pi. That's a job for the viewer. And then after that, we then jump up to 44,899. Then we go up to the big one at 79,873,884. So that's our first one in the very first position. Then we go to our second one at 16,000, the third one 44,000. And then the fourth self-locating string at 79 million.
Tom, would you guess that there are an infinite number of these?
I'm inclined to say yes, with the idea being that pi is an infinite string of decimals, and you might expect that because it's infinite, you would hope that every string of numbers should be in there at some point. But then you've got this extra condition that not only does the number have to appear, it needs to appear at a certain place. So that's why these are quite rare. It's a difficult question, for sure. It's a good question.
All right, but there's another way to look at this.
There is indeed. So, and this is the reason why I did write out the first 100. So I'm going to take a different color, because you may have wondered why I labeled the first position here, the 1, as index 1. Because you could also, of course, completely, you know, it could be completely valid to label this as 0. So if we call this now the 0th spot, and then this one the first and the second, and of course we continue in the same way, we now have a slightly different index. We're going to go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Bingo. So we've got our first one now at the sixth position, indexing from 0. And then if we carry on, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. So there's a 2 in position 20, but then there's a 6, so it doesn't work. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, we have a 2, and then we've got a 7. So we've actually found our second self-locating string in positions 27 and 28. We've got 6, we've got 27, and then we jump up to a number kind of near 16,000. 13,598 is our next third self-locating string. So it's not too far away from the 16,000 on index 1. Then we go up to 43,611. Again, maybe it's a coincidence, maybe it's not, but it's quite similar to what we saw before. And then finally, this one is less close, but at least has the same number of digits. We get 24,643,510. And that is the final, that's going to be what, 5. So we actually have one more self-locating string in the first 100 million digits of pi when doing it indexing 0. So as I said, there isn't a convention between index 0 or 1, but we're going to now stick with index 1 from now on, just to be clear. And the perhaps more interesting question about these, it's super cool finding them, and you should totally go away and try and find your own. But the other interesting thing you can do is ask the question of, do these things loop back around on themselves? So what I mean by that is if I pick a starting point, for example, 169, let's suppose it's my favorite number. Well, actually, let's suppose it's the favorite number of Dan Sikorsky, who is the guy who found this out. So this is Dan's favorite number. And what we do is we then look for, well, where does the number 169 appear in the decimal expansion of pi? And we should be able to spot it. There it is. 169 is down here. And because I did this earlier, this is going to come in at position 40, starting here. So the number 169, so we've got 40th, 41st, 42nd, appears in position 40. So now you say, we started with 169, and that has sort of taken us to position 40 in the expansion. So then you say, well, now where does 40 appear in the expansion of pi? So we're going to try and create some kind of pathway through this infinite decimal expansion.
I imagine 40 appears all over the place.
Exactly. So we're going to look for the first occurrence of 40, the sort of the lowest down one. That's the idea. So 40 is going to appear at the 70th position. So the 4 is at 70 and the 0 is at 71. So we started at 169, 40th position. We looked for 40. That's taken us to the 70th position. So now we look for 70. That's the idea. So 70 is coming in right down the bottom. And this is why I wrote out 100 digits. So 70 is down here in position 96 is the starting number. So we've gone 169 to 40 to 70 to 96. And now we're going to look for 96 and we're going to carry on and we're going to see where we end up. So 96 is going to take us miles away to 180. Then we go, this is a pretty long route, we then go through 3,664. Then we look for that number which appears in the 24,717th position. Then we go to 15,492. Then we go 84,198. So I think this is the highest point of our path that we descend into the madness of the decimal expansion of pi. So that then goes back down to 65,489,3725. There is a point to this, I promise. Then we get to 16,974,41,702,3788,5757,1958. 14,609,62,892,44,745, and then we go to 9,385, and finally we get 169 again. So we loop back round to 169, which appears in the 40th position. So the mathematical question here is, given any random starting number that we just choose of any number of digits, do we always get a loop? That's the mathematical. So it seems like a bit of fun, but there's like a really deep mathematical question into this. Do you always get this loop that's going to happen? Given any starting number, will you always find a loop? The loop can be of any length. It could be very short. It could be quite long. It could, but you know, as long as it's not infinite length, then you would loop back around. And we have no clue, as far as I'm aware. This is just a sort of puzzling question. But there is one thing that we can say, which is that not every number will have an infinite loop, because this is where we come back to the self-locating strings and my new favorite thing at the moment. Because if you end up at a self-locating string, so if you somehow come across 1 or 16,470, you don't move, because 1 is in position 1. So you get to 1 and then you just loop back around, or you get to 16,470 and loop back around.
So they're like dead ends, or?
They're basically dead ends. So the self-locating strings stop these loops from happening. And I do have an example of one loop which terminates at 1. If we start at 211, so a random starting number, this appears actually back in here at position here, 2, 1, and then 1 down here. So annoyingly over two lines, but we've got our number here, 211. And this is at position 93. This one here is the 93rd position. So we go 211 to 93. Where does 93 appear? 93 but there's an earlier one.
Oh,
hey, this is good. Always go to the earliest. Yeah. This is it's just a rule. It's an arbitrary rule, and you could change the rules, but for the purpose of our loops, we're going to the first appearance of that number.
Yep.
So you were completely correct, but this is going to be the one, and this is at position 14. And now, where does 14 appear in pi? I think you know this one, Brady, maybe. Right at the beginning. So 14 is in position 1. So we've gone 211 to 93 to 14, and then we've gone to 1, and then we just loop back around forever and we're stuck at 1. So 1, our self-locating string here, is the dead end. You either have this big loop that goes, or you know, some size of loop where you just keep going round and round in circles. You either reach your dead end, as you called it, the self-locating string, which just circles back to itself forever. Or can we find a path? And as again, as far as I'm aware, no one has found such a path where you just keep going forever and ever and ever. As far as I'm aware, there's no point to this. This is, as I said, I found this on the Pi search page. It's recreational maths. But then it does lead to quite a deep question, the patterns of numbers within the expansion of Pi. So whilst, even if we were able to answer that question, it probably wouldn't tell us much about Pi itself. But the methods and the techniques you're going to use to do such a proof are going to probably be brand new and lead to all kinds of other awesome stuff. It's like the classic case of, you know, trying to climb a particular peak. There's not really that much at the peak, but it's everything, all the other peaks you scale to get to that one. It's all the other new stuff you discover then has all these other amazing uses. And loads of really big results in maths come from recreational playing around with numbers, this kind of thing.
This is the first 5 million digits of pi printed on 2,000 pieces of paper. And if you would like your very own piece of pi, I'm going to be signing these and sending them out to Numberphile viewers. To find out how to get one, have a look in the video description or go to patreon.com/numberphile. There's details there too. I better get started on this. This is going to take a while.
The motion of fluids crashing into each other. So we have two cases of the Reynolds number. We've got big Reynolds number, so we say it's not just greater than 1, it's much greater than 1, so sort of 1,000 and above turbulence. And your equations, so we've got rid now.